Let's talk about building your very own Steam machine in 2024 and what that looks like. Today, we're going to revisit this Steam machine that I built a while back. I made a video talking about building my very own Steam machine just over a year ago, and I think now is a good time to check in on it with you. Regrettably, it doesn't really get the love it deserves, collecting dust under our living room TV next to my Nintendo Switch. Is it obvious that the Steam Deck gets most of my attention? My plan today, though, is to revitalize my Steam box and put it in a case that's even smaller and more portable. It's actually the same case I used to take to PDX land when I used to fly over to Portland, Oregon from time to time. This is the Dan Case A4, one of my favorite cases from my past that I kind of just held on to thinking I'd use it again for a project someday. I think it's worth noting here that this is the V4 version of the case that only includes a PCIe 3.0 extension cable, rather than the newer 4.0 standard. The GPU that's going in here is a PCIe 3.0 card, but I did have to go into the motherboard's BIOS and manually set the PCIe lane to 3.0 to prevent the system from crashing to a black screen. You can buy replacement PCIe 4.0 extensions for about $70 on Amazon, but for now I'm sticking with this one since it's totally fine for what I'm using it for. Likely, you won't be using an older version of a case like I am, but I've actually noticed even the most popular lunchbox style cases being sold on Amazon only have a PCIe 3.0 cable in them, so be mindful of that. You can always run a newer PCIe 4.0 graphics card at 3.0 speeds with minimal impact to performance. It just matters that you know you need to do a little digging in the BIOS to make sure it's set up properly. Hopefully that's helpful for someone wanting to do what I'm doing here. Anyway, moving on, CPU cooling is going to be much more limited here versus what it was in the Cooler Master NR200P case that I used previously. But the Ryzen 7 5700G that I'm reusing only has a TDP of 65 watts. This low profile Noctua cooler, the L9A, will actually be totally enough to handle the heat that this thing will put out. By the way, I'm planning on basically just reusing all of the same components that I did last time, with the exception of the case and that CPU cooler I just mentioned. There's no way the previous cooler will fit, and it was way overkill anyway. As much as I'd love to see this thing get any sort of upgrade, I'm not sure it would be worth it for me at this time. I mean, if you help me by clicking the subscribe button, and maybe someday I'll make a little money through monetization. Either way, a like and a sub to the channel would be huge for me. I'm less than 100 subs away from making it to 1,000. But like I said, same power supply, same 1 terabyte SSD, same motherboard and CPU, and especially the same Radeon 7 that I picked up for the original project that I got at a good price. I'll have a PC part picker list in the description so you can see all of the components in detail. Another reason I wanted to do this Steam machine refresh was because I wanted to try out Bazzite, a Linux gaming-centric OS that has been getting some attention recently that lets you use your device just like you would a Steam Deck. It even boots straight into what Valve still calls big picture mode, just like the Steam Deck. Originally, I used Chimera OS, which worked fine. Later, I installed Holo ISO just to give it a try and never really made any content about it because I didn't see the need to. But with Bazzite, I think it's interesting to take a look at because they have done a good job of supporting some gaming handhelds like the ROG Ally, Lenovo Legion Go, and a few others from the likes of GPD and Ein. I'm sure it wasn't too hard to do, but Bazzite also supports the ROG Ally X, which just came out, so that's really cool to see. Bazzite also makes downloading all of the things you'd need by visiting the desktop environment for the first time, and it's all seemingly right there, easily accessible. Visiting their website, bazzite.gg, you can see that they've put a lot of effort into making this OS very approachable. which I can really appreciate. If you're not super tech savvy, they present everything in a very clean and straightforward way. Select what device you're going to be installing Bazzite on. In our case, I'm choosing home theater PC since it supports GameScope, which is how you see all of the stats up on the screen when I'm playing games. And it's stated here that it has great support with AMD and Intel GPUs. If you have an NVIDIA GPU, you can still try Bazzite, but the setup seems more complicated and lacks the features you get by sticking with Intel or AMD. For the best experience, I'd recommend just sticking with AMD since that's what powers the Steam Deck. Use something like Rufus or Balina Etcher to install the ISO files to your flash drive of choice to make a bootable drive and let it rip. In my case, I just need to go into the boot menu and select my flash drive so I can boot from that and wipe my current installation of HoloISO. If you're working with a fresh drive though, you won't have to worry about that. Go through the setup process and you're ready to do some gaming. Just after you download some games, that is. Speaking of games, let's talk about what games I've been testing on my freshly rebuilt Steam machine. I want to emphasize that I'm not trying to push things to its limits, but I'm going to do my best to get all of these games running at 1440p, 60fps whenever possible, which doesn't mean I can run things at max settings, but that's actually fine with me. Since this will likely live under my TV, capping the FPS to 60 to maintain a cool and quiet system is always a priority for me. Some of these games, I wish I had a bit more horsepower to run them, but for the sake of this project and my wallet, I'll make it work. Here's one of my favorite games to play on both the Steam Deck and my PC, Hitman World of Assassination. Running this at 1440p with whatever setting it's set to by default, I don't think I had FSR on here, but whatever it was set to, I think it looks great. Constant 60fps here, and even though I'm not amazing at this game, playing Hitman on this system was probably some of the most fun I've had with this game in a long time. Bioshock Infinite is my choice for an older title here in my round of testing. 1440p, and this one kind of threw me off a little bit. I was fully expecting to get 60fps without any issues, but for whatever reason and doing no research as to why, Bioshock Infinite would never make it up to 60fps, hovering between 52 and 56fps. The frame time graph, as you can see, is pretty consistent though, so gameplay was totally smooth. It was just odd that it wouldn't lock at 60 for me. Either way, this was an enjoyable experience, and it was kind of neat going back and playing through a snippet of this game since I haven't played it since the Xbox 360 days. Rest in peace, the Xbox 360 marketplace. Helldivers 2 just had one of its biggest updates yet in the form of the Escalation for Freedom update. This footage was pre-update though, and we're running the game at 1440p low settings, and with render scale set to ultra quality. You can see we're maintaining an almost solid 60fps, and I think the game looks fine. Totally playable here, but it would have been nice to have a little more GPU horsepower to crank the settings up a bit more and make it look a little bit nicer. But still, I could see someone playing just like this and having a great time. Unlike my Helldiver getting murdered constantly by stalkers. GTA 5 here with the built-in benchmark. I guess I could have included this one as an old title as well because it came out on 360. Whatever, it's an old game. We're still waiting for GTA 6. I forgot to unlock the frame limit here. This is the benchmark, by the way, but I forgot to unlock the frame limit, and you can see me changing that in the side menu. It didn't really make a huge difference, and I probably would just leave the frame limit set to 60 hertz to keep things a little bit more consistent. Here at the end of the benchmark, the game kind of crashed. I don't really know what that's about, but moving on over to some gameplay. For some reason, my save didn't load. Not sure if that's a Steam issue or a Rockstar issue, but oh well. I'd probably want to restart my game anyway since it's been so long since I played this game. I think what I did here too was I locked the frame limit to 60, like I was saying, and the game played great. Not much to really say about this. Once Human is a weird one. Up front, this game does not work well on this setup. I wanted to include it because it's a pretty recent release that I think people are still playing, question mark. It did this really weird thing that I've never seen before. It took forever to process shaders, but if I moved the joystick around on the controller, it made the progress go up. I have no idea what's going on here, but it was really goofy. The game doesn't have controller support, so I used mouse and keyboard here. The game works, but you can see the stuttering when I move the camera. It's awful. If you just move forward and don't move the camera, it's fine. But anytime I move the camera, it's a mess. Maybe it'll get fixed in the future, but as it is right now, I do not recommend a system like this for what's human. The First Descendant here is another recent release that I've actually been really enjoying. Here, we're in one of the first areas in the game. Settings set to low, and we can get a pretty solid 60 FPS. Frame timing is actually pretty great here too. This game does have controller support, but I'm using mouse and key here. I've actually played this game a ton since I've recorded this and unlocked a few new characters. This game kind of reminds me a bit of Destiny and Warframe, if you're into those. But yeah, pretty solid performance here. Again, I would have liked a little bit more GPU horsepower here since this game is kind of pretty with the settings cranked, but it's totally playable at low settings. In my previous video where I talked about building a Steam machine, I had a few issues here and there, mostly revolving around connecting Bluetooth controllers. I can say that most of these issues haven't been a problem this time around. The controller that I use is the 8-bit DOE Ultimate that uses a 2.4 GHz dongle. Using that, I've had zero issues. And I understand that you can now rename Bluetooth controllers to avoid any bit of confusion you may have pairing multiple of the same controller like Xbox controllers, which is a nice addition. And for the most part, I really didn't have any other issues, other than the glaring problems that I had with Once Human, but that was game specific. My only major issue that I had with this new Steam machine configuration running Bazzite is that I could never get HDR to work. Having recently experienced how nice OLED is with HDR on the OLED Steam Deck, I wanted to see if I could get HDR on my OLED TV here in my office to work with this. But sadly, once enabled, everything turns green and it looks atrocious.
HDR off. HDR on. Wow.
Wow. Wow. Beautiful. Wow.
Maybe when Valve finally gets around to releasing an official SteamOS, maybe then I can get it to work. And maybe it's even a hardware issue, but I wouldn't know until I get a newer GPU in this thing someday. Valve actually said recently that they'll be supporting the ROG Ally family of devices with SteamOS. So who knows, maybe the official release is right around the corner. Would I change anything about this Steam machine? Of course, like I mentioned several times, it would be pretty cool to have a more modern and powerful GPU in here. The Radeon 7 is kind of an odd choice. It fits in this case nicely, since it's only a 2-slot card, and the 16GB of HBM2 VRAM is nice, but you'll never really utilize more than 8GB at the resolutions that this system will play comfortably. That's why if you're trying to replicate this system for yourself, I'd say that a used 5700 XT would get you roughly the same performance at a much cheaper price. So better GPU and maybe a new platform to upgrade from AM4 to AM5, and maybe one of the new 9000 series CPUs, since they seem pretty power efficient, and that would work well in a smaller system like what I have here. The DAN case is pretty limiting, making it only possible to use 2-slot GPUs. So if I ever did get a newer GPU for this, I would have to keep that in mind. That might force me to pick up a newer ITX case though. Maybe something like the Fractal Design Terra, because I'm a sucker for some nice wood. Because I'm a sucker for some nice wood. But that's it. That's my experience with building my very own Linux-based gaming console and using Bazzite for the first time. What do you think? Is there something I should have tested or tried, or would you have done something differently? Leave a comment down below to let me know. Don't forget to leave a like and subscribe to the channel to help it grow. And we'll see you next time. Whenever that is. Have a good week. Also, check out this sweet shirt. Look at it. Okay, bye.